the media environment the pro-lifers are facing, I think, is just the worst it's ever been, where there aren't child predators out there who use abortion to cover up their misconduct. And I'm not really convinced, based on what we've seen, that abortion facilities are really all that diligent about following up on these things. So, yeah, I think that the kind of misconduct that goes on in abortion facilities is, you know, very serious. It can be catastrophic. You know, very heartened by what's gone on after Dobbs. I think, you know, a number of states, you know, have really taken the lead and are really passing, you know, very strong protective pro-life laws. Policy can change. You know, legal abortion's not, you know, inevitable. That, you know, going through the work of electing pro-life people and educating people and taking care of pregnant women in need, you know, these steps do add up. But I just think we need to, you know, move forward with confidence. I mean, we've been working for this day for over 49 years, and we need to take full advantage of this to protect as many preborn children as possible.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. My guest today is Dr. Michael New, who is an assistant professor of practice at the Busch School of Business at the Catholic University of America. And he's here today to help us unpack and understand some recent developments in the pro-life movement. Dr. New has done a variety of research on various political topics surrounding the pro-life movement, and he's going to help us understand some recent things that are going on. Michael, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Much appreciated.
Yeah, great. Well, first of all, your main occupation is to be a professor at the Busch School of Business at CUA, but you're also affiliated with the Charlotte Lozier Institute, isn't that right?
Yeah, that's correct. I am an associate scholar. I was actually the first associate scholar that Lozier hired. I was very excited that the only think tank working on abortion for a long time was Guttmacher, which up until 2006 or 2007 was the official research arm of Planned Parenthood. And we had pro-life researchers, but we weren't coordinated. So yeah. The Lozier Institute's been a real blessing. You know, they can help get op-eds placed, you know, organize events on Capitol Hill and really amplify the voices of pro-life researchers like myself.
Okay, so you're, and you come at it from a kind of statistical and political side of things, is that correct?
Yeah, I like to write about the social science of sanctity of life issues. I write about abortion trends, pro-life laws, public opinion, contraception programs. I like to tell people I'm lots of fun at cocktail parties.
Well, welcome to the club. We have a lot of nerds over here at the Ruth Institute. And in fact, my sister is a CPA, and she and I, and I'm an economist, and she and I joke around that if we want to clear the buffet table at a family gathering, we just start talking tax talk and everybody scatters, you know. But the people who follow us at the Ruth Institute have a good nerd feel to them. So people are going to be very interested in what you have to say. One thing that caught my eye was the recent failure of the pro-life amendment in the state of Kansas. And this is one of the first electoral issues that came up post-Dobbs, after the Dobbs decision overturning Roe v. Wade. Michael, walk people through what that election was about, and then tell us why you think we got the outcome that we got.
Yeah, sure. So this kind of predates the Dobbs decision. You know, that in 2019, the Kansas Supreme Court issued a ruling, and they found that there was a right to an abortion in the Kansas state constitution. You know, I think that's a bad ruling. I think these were, you know, liberal activist judges, but that's the ruling they issued. And pro-life people in Kansas were concerned. They were concerned that, you know, this ruling is a bad precedent. It might invalidate current pro-life laws that are currently on the books. It might invalidate or hinder future efforts to enact pro-life laws in Kansas. So they wanted to put an amendment in the state constitution that would just make it clear the state constitution does not contain a right to an abortion. And other states have done similar things. Louisiana, you know, where you're located, has an amendment of that nature. Tennessee, Mississippi does as well. What made this a bit different, of course, was the Dobbs decision. And as you know, Dobbs was handed down on June 24th. It was a very exciting victory, something that pro-lifers have worked, you know, long and hard for. And this is really the first kind of major kind of a political campaign that involved abortion that took place after Dobbs. And I think, you know, we have to realize a couple of things. I think first off,
hold on before we go there. So let me just be clear the timeline in my mind. Okay, mm-hmm. So this amendment was already on the ballot, and that process was already in place to have the election, but nobody knew that Dobbs was going to happen.
Correct. At least we didn't realize that it would result in the reversal of Roe v. Wade. I mean, Dobbs was, you know, working its way through the court, but we didn't know whether the Supreme Court would, you know, accept it. And even when they did accept the case, you know, we weren't really sure, you know, what they would rule. You know, there was always a possibility they would just rule on the merits of the Mississippi law and not necessarily involve, you know, Roe v. Wade directly. So, you know, this was Kansas' initiative. This ballot proposal was designed kind of well before Dobbs.
Gotcha. Okay. And so, probably most people who follow this situation know that the amendment did not pass. Mm-hmm. And so give people your analysis about why you think that was.
Well, first off, I think that, you know, I appreciate the good work of pro-lifers in Kansas. I mean, various Catholic dioceses did invest heavily in the campaign, and, you know, many good pro-life groups like you know, Students Life of America and Susan B. Anthony List. I should say Susan B. Anthony Pro-Life America did, you know, make strong investments in this campaign. That said, I think the local activists in Kansas were kind of blindsided by the onslaught of one outside money and outside media. I think the other side really invested heavily in efforts to oppose this amendment. And I think that to some extent may have caught some of the local pro-lifers off guard. One thing we do know, I've done research on direct democracy. One thing we know is that money plays a very big role in who wins these campaigns. And unfortunately, we were outspent. We were outspent by, it looks like, more than $1 million. And a lot of that money that opposed, you know, value them both came from out of state. It was big, you know, DC nonprofits like Planned Parenthood and the ACLU were pumping a lot of money into opposition efforts. This was not money that came from, you know, grassroots Kansas. So, right. You know, outside groups really swooped in. You know, abortion is a multi-billion dollar industry. These groups have money to spend, and they spent quite a lot of it in Kansas. And, you know, I think that that played a role. So, you know, I think money was a problem. Another problem was that, you know, again, I think this was worded in a somewhat confusing way. I think that when we were successful in Louisiana and other states, the wording was much simpler. It was just a right to an abortion is not found in the Constitution. You know, this kind of had a convoluted wording that I think confused some people. And I think that, you know, may have also played a role in its defeat. The other thing I'll just say is that, you know, pro-lifers have done well in direct democracy campaigns, but we've done well when a couple circumstances hold. First, the campaign has to be in a fairly conservative state. That did hold. The second is that it has to be incremental and kind of hard to caricature or demonize. That didn't really hold. That we've won direct democracy efforts to pass pro-life parental involvement laws in states like Florida and Montana and Alaska. We've won direct democracy efforts to stop taxpayer funding of abortion through Medicaid in states like Arkansas and Colorado and West Virginia. So when it's kind of incremental, we can do well with direct democracy. When it's a little bit broader, that's harder. The other side tried very hard to make the case that if you pass value them both, abortion will be banned everywhere. Mm-hmm. Now, that's not the case. This just kind of allows the state legislature to do certain things, protect the freeborn. It wouldn't trigger an automatic abortion ban. But the other side, I think, was able to spend a lot of money and confuse people that could lead to an abortion ban. And I think that's kind of what played a role in the amendment's defeat.
And probably the fact that it came on the heels of the Dobbs decision had people ginned up to really be paying attention to that aspect. People probably more sensitive to that than they would have been without Dobbs. Or do you think that's the case?
Yeah, I think that's the case. And I'd also say that, to be honest, the media environment the pro-lifers are facing, I think, is just the worst it's ever been. You do see a lot of media outlets are giving a lot of stories to, or a lot of coverage, I should say, to, you know, women who, you know, are pregnant in difficult circumstances, who in some cases are unfortunately not necessarily getting the medical care they need. Now, I want to make it clear, that's not because of the pro-life laws. You know, pro-lifers want pregnant women to get the best and finest medical care available to them. You know, we want women who suffer miscarriages to get medical care. We want women facing ectopic pregnancies to get appropriate medical care. That said, you know, in a country of hundreds of millions of people, you know, there have been instances where some physicians have misunderstood, the laws in place or have made poor judgments. And there are a few sad instances where some pregnant women, have not necessarily maybe gotten the care or the proper care they deserve. Now, that's not the fault of pro-lifers. Medical professionals need to be, aware of the law and need to realize that, they can, and they need to care for pregnant women, who are suffering miscarriages, who are suffering ectopic pregnancies. But these stories have gotten a lot of attention, and that's kind of made the media environment, very difficult for us right now.
Yes. Now, that brings me to the next set of questions that I wanted to ask you, Michael, because you've done more research on state-level pro-life laws than anybody that I'm aware of. Mm-hmm. And you use the term direct democracy. I'd like you to define what you mean by direct democracy in this context.
Sure. That, in most cases, most laws are passed by, legislators that we elect, that they make decisions about what laws to pass, and laws can be passed through a state house, a state senate, and then signed by a governor. There are about, 26 states where citizens can bypass the state legislature. If someone circulates a petition that gets a lot of signatures, you need a lot of signatures. They right. don't want, hundreds of thousands of things, on the ballot. So it's not easy to get these things on the ballot, but there is a way to kind of bypass the state legislature and put a question on the ballot for people to decide directly.
So now that we've explained what we mean by direct democracy, that's a citizen initiative, basically, is what you mean by direct democracy. There have been some state-level pro-life laws that have been enacted either by direct democracy or sometimes by the legislatures. I'm interested to know what kinds of abortion regulations the Supreme Court permitted us to have prior to Dobbs during the Roe era, because a lot of things were thrown out as being an undue burden, I think was the terminology that was used. But some state-level pro-life laws did survive that passage, that whole constitutional process. Give us some examples. What kinds of laws have states passed in the Roe era, and how effective were those laws?
Yeah, sure. I mean, even though the Roe v. Wade decision was an obstacle for pro-lifers, we were able to pass certain kinds of laws and take some incremental steps toward building a culture of life. The best thing that we did, in the post-Roe era, was stop taxpayer funding of abortion through Medicaid. In 1976, we passed the Hyde Amendment. That limited the ability of the federal government to pay for abortions through the federal Medicaid, or at least pay for elective abortions through the federal Medicaid program. That was passed in 1976. It was actually upheld by the Supreme Court in 1980 in Harris v. McRae. And there's a very, very good body of evidence that suggests that when you stop taxpayer funding of abortion, abortion numbers go down. Almost every researcher agrees. Pro-life groups agree with this. Groups that oppose legal, or groups I should say that support legal abortion agree with this. Center for Reproductive Rights, obviously a group that supports legal abortion, they did an analysis of this about 12 years ago. They found the Hyde Amendment had stopped over a million abortions. I did a analysis for the Lozier Institute. It first came out in 2016. I updated it in 2020. I found the Hyde Amendment saved over 2.4 million lives. So, just getting the federal government out of the business of funding abortion through taxpayer dollars, that saves a lot of lives.
That's a federal level policy. Do the states have comparable authority in maybe not with Medicaid, but in some other way? Are some states financing abortions through state level taxation? Is that an issue?
Yeah, unfortunately, yes. I mean, Medicaid is kind of a complicated program in the sense that, there's, every state has its own Medicaid program, as does Washington, D.C., and states can make decisions about, what to cover and whom to cover.
Okay, so that's one whole area of pro-life laws. Presumably, there are other kinds of statutes and policies that can take place at the state level that you've examined. I'm thinking things like parental notification and stuff like that. Waiting periods. What kinds of things would the court allow to go through? I remember there were some of the regulations that seemed like they were regulating the clinic itself. Some of those got thrown out as being an undue burden on women and stuff like that. So can you give us kind of the rundown of what the court permitted states to do? And then we can talk about which of these things were effective.
Sure. I mean, basically, kind of post-Roe, post-Casey, states could regulate abortion, but the regulation, couldn't impose what they called an undue burden to a woman seeking an abortion. So again, that meant that, there could be regulations, but those regulations just couldn't be, in the eyes of the court, too burdensome. Okay. So like one thing the court was pretty good about upholding, at least starting in the early 80s, was pro-life parental involvement laws. So these are laws that require minor girls to either notify their parents before they obtain an abortion or get permission from their parents before they obtain an abortion. The Supreme Court was pretty good about upholding them. Informed consent laws were upheld. These are laws that give women seeking abortions information. That information can include things about fetal development. It can include information about public and private source support for unborn, for mothers and children. It can include things about potential health risks involved with an abortion. So informed consent laws just gave women information about, fetal development and alternatives. The court, for the most part, upheld these. Waiting periods, for the most part, were upheld. So requiring that women get this information and spend 24, 48, 72 hours thinking about it, that was upheld. So, obviously, these, regulations weren't, magical, but, they, at the margin, they did have an impact, that you give women an alternative, some will take the alternative. So, these laws, did help us out incrementally. My research and the research of others show that these laws are well designed and enforced properly. They did lower the abortion rate, by a few percent, did save some lives, and did spare many women a lifetime of regret.
And so the salient thing about that is that each legislature could figure out what they wanted to try in their in their state and pass those laws. And so a place like Mississippi would have one set of laws and a place like California would have something completely different. But it was allowed, the states were allowed to have some variation in that. And that's what you're studying to say, it seems to have worked. The impact of the law seems to have changed the abortion rate. Is that what you're telling us?
Oh, yes, that we've been able to kind of track abortion rates in the various states. Pro-life laws, do have an impact.
Okay. And so if we take this whole body of information of what we now know about incremental pro-life laws and so on and so forth, do you have any sort of counsel, or do people seek your counsel about what kinds of statutes and regulations and so on various states might want to try to at least incrementally reduce abortion rates?
Obviously, it depends on the state. Obviously, mm-hmm. Post-Dobbs, we have a lot more opportunities. I think we should try to shoot for the most protective laws that we can. But obviously, we have to make sometimes just prudential judgments about what we can get through a state legislature and what a governor may be inclined to sign. Right now I'm very heartened by what's gone on after Dobbs. I think a number of states have really taken the lead and are really passing very strong protective pro-life laws. I think as of sometime in mid to late September, about 16 states are going to have protective laws in place, that protect preborn children, after a certain point in gestation. And, Guttmacher, their analysts think that number will rise up to about 26 states over time. So, I just think that, the good thing we can do past Dobbs that we couldn't do before is we can actually protect preborn children after a certain point in gestation. And in fact, we can even pass laws that protect all preborn children.
And one of the big things I want to just highlight, one of the things you mentioned, is that you can now have limits based on gestational age that were never allowed before. And I think a lot of people don't understand that. And I think, for example, the European Union seems to not understand that, because they came down and they're hollering at us about how terrible we are that we no longer have Roe versus Wade. But most of them have much more restrictive laws based on gestational age than was allowed under Roe v. Wade. What do you think about that, Michael?
I think it's very odd. I mean, if you look at most European countries, their laws prior to when Roe v. Wade was in effect in the U.S., most European countries had far more protective laws. Many European countries did not allow abortion, after 12 weeks gestation. Right. I mean, their policies in many respects were far more quote unquote conservative than ours. So, I think it's kind of odd that they're, chirping at us right now the way they are. That I think that even the Mississippi law would have been seen as something of an outlier, many European countries. I think that many European countries, had a law that would be considered more protective than what Mississippi did, trying to protect preborn children after 15 weeks gestation. So, the criticism that we're getting from abroad is, to be honest, kind of hypocritical.
Well, and not only that, I mean, I think part of it reflects the position of the United States as being kind of the global leader in abortion. Mm-hmm. You know, for the longest time, the United States, under the Roe v. Wade regime, we have been, you know, really promoting abortion heavily around the world through the United Nations and through private organizations and things like that. And so if the United States isn't doing that anymore, then everybody who's relying on us, they can't rely on us in quite the same way anymore, I suppose.
No, they really cannot point to the U.S. as, you know, a place whose policy they want to emulate. You know, right now our states can go ahead and enact protected pro-life laws, and, you know, we can't necessarily be seen as a place that's kind of, quote unquote, exporting abortion to the rest of the world. On the other hand, one thing I'm excited to hear is that a lot of our pro-life counterparts in other countries are very excited about what's happened here.
Yes.
They feel that if, you know, states can go ahead and overturn Roe v. Wade and start enacting pro-life laws, that they can do the same thing in their country. So I think that what happened is giving a lot of encouragement, a lot of hope to our pro-life friends and allies in other countries. I just think it gave pro-life counterparts, you know, overseas, just some encouragement that policy can change, you know, legal abortion's not, you know, inevitable, that, you know, going through the work of electing pro-life people and educating people and taking care of pregnant women in need, you know, these steps do add up. And, here in the United States, we weren't, you know, tilting at windmills. And I would even argue before Roe v. Wade, our efforts are paying off. I mean, we can talk about this more later on. But one thing I tell every pro-life audience that would listen to me is one thing the pro-life movement did even before Dobbs is we got abortion numbers down. We cut the abortion rate by more than 50% since 1980. That gets very little attention. And, you know, I think an important reason for this is because a higher percentage of unintended pregnancies are being carried in term. You know, we have data, oddly enough, from Guttmacher and the World Health Organization. In the early 1990s, about half of unintended pregnancies in the U.S. were aborted. Wow. By the, 2015, 2019, only about a third of unintended pregnancies in the U.S. were aborted. And I tell pro-life audiences this all the time, because if more and more women are choosing life, it shows our efforts are effective. If more women are choosing life because of one of three reasons, we're either changing hearts and minds, persuading women, or we're taking better care of women by, offering more and better services through pregnancy help centers, or we're passing protective pro-life laws. So the abortion decline, I think, all flows back to the good activities of pro-lifers everywhere. So I always try to give pro-lifers, hope and encouragement. You know, it was a long road to overturn Roe v. Wade, but even, though we didn't succeed, even though it took us 49 years, we made progress in other ways. And one big way we made progress is getting the abortion rate down. Cutting the abortion rate in half was a big deal. If the abortion rate today were what it was back in 1980 when it peaked, there'd be a million more abortions taking place every year. So again, every year, we've saved a million unborn children and we've spared a million women from a lifetime of regret.
Well, that's really something. I recently came across a study or a report from the National Abortion Federation that was cataloging violence by pro-lifers against abortion clinics. And I saw this report. I was not familiar with this report. Evidently, this organization puts out a report every year on this topic of violence that abortion clinics experience from pro-lifers, presumably. Mm-hmm. Are you familiar with that report, Michael, and what can you tell us about it?
I am familiar with that report. And, I think you have to remember several things about it. First off, it's put out by the National Abortion Federation. This is a group that obviously supports legal abortion. They want to stigmatize, and in some cases even criminalize, legitimate pro-life activity. This is a group that opposes sidewalk counseling. Right. They would support bubble zones to prevent, pro-lifers like myself who spend time sidewalk counseling and trying to offer, alternatives to pregnant women in need. So, they really have a real interest in trying to kind of play up the amount of, disruption that goes on around abortion clinics. That's one thing. Secondly, a lot of what they present in that report is not really substantiated. They don't necessarily link to police reports or media coverage. A lot of the statistics that they cite just aren't well documented, in my opinion. So you have to kind of realize, that is as well. And also it's important to remember that there really is no surge in, violence around abortion facilities. I think in the past 10 years, there has been one shooting at an abortion clinic. And that was a tragic case that took place in Colorado, and what happened was wrong and reprehensible. And pro-lifers, we condemn that. But again, it's once in 10 years. So the notion that there is this, you know, surge of violence around abortion facilities is just, you know, very, very misleading. You know, I think that, you know, I looked at the numbers and I find that, you know, there really was no consistent increase, you know, in recent years. They try to always make it as if that there's a lot more violence, a lot more disruption, but their own data does not really bear that out.
Well, and if I read it, you know, and I said to myself, I see what they're saying, but I'm not that familiar with how they're saying it. I'm going to ask Michael. I sent it off to you, you know. But what I noticed, Michael, tell me if this is correct, is it's a survey of abortion providers. So they send out, you know, a survey to their members, I guess, who are abortion, you know, abortion clinics and abortion doctors and so on, and ask them what has happened, you know, ask them to categorize things that have happened at their clinic. Mm-hmm. But as you say, what they think of as harassment or violence may not meet somebody else's definition of that. So am I right that this is all self-reported stuff?
Yeah, it's all self-reported. And, you know, again, it doesn't necessarily link to media coverage or police reports. And, you know, they, you know, would view sidewalk counseling as harassment. Right. Even just praying, you know, they might even view as harassment. People just do who pray outside facilities. They would probably, you know, view that as picketing or harassment. So, you know, again, I think that it's self-reported. There's obviously no outside review, no peer review. It's just simply, you know, as in fact, I even discussed this. I was actually asked to testify in a court case. I just said this is numbers on a sheet of paper.
Right. Okay. But do you know anything about what is permitted on the sidewalk and what is not permitted on the sidewalk? Because we know our dear friend, Walter Hoy, Reverend Walter Hoy, who's actually a board member of the Ruth Institute. You probably know Walter spent 30 days in jail in Oakland, California, because of a clinic bubble access law that was later found unconstitutional, where he was not allowed to talk to ladies if he was too close to the clinic and so on and so forth. What do you know, or what do we know generally about clinic access laws? How draconian are they? How many states have them? What do we know about that, Michael?
Yeah, I'm not really an expert, you know, but by and large, Supreme Court has upheld the free speech rights of pro-lifers outside abortion facilities. I mean, we had a case involving, you know, a Massachusetts law that went to the Supreme Court, and, you know, they struck down the bubble zone. So by and large, you know, your First Amendment rights don't end just because you're near an abortion facility. You know, again, people, you know, the Supreme Court has upheld the right of people to picket abortion facilities. They have consistently upheld the rights of people to sidewalk counsel. So again, you know, I've always told people to, you know, go out with confidence. You know, if somehow police do tell you to cease and desist, you know, I do tell people to obey law enforcement, but, you know, write down the name of the police officer who, you know, gave you that order and contact lawyers. You know, groups like the Thomas More Society do a very good job protecting the free speech rights of pro-lifers everywhere. So, again, sidewalk counseling, I think, has been shown to be constitutionally protected. And, you know, we have not stopped our efforts post-Dobbs. In fact, I would argue that sidewalk counselors probably can be even more effective post-Dobbs.
Yes.
I'm heartened to hear that even in states where unborn children are protected, sidewalk counselors still go to abortion facilities. Because even if those facilities aren't doing abortions, they do referrals. And to be honest, maybe that pregnancy help center down the street looks a lot more attractive than traveling several states away to obtain the abortion. So, you know, here in D.C., you know, we maintain our efforts. I help organize sidewalk counseling outside the D.C. Planned Parenthood. You know, after Dobbs, you know, we've had some, you know, more snarky comments, a little more pushback, but nothing bad's happened to us. You know, nobody's been beaten up, nobody's been assaulted. So, you know, we just keep doing our work, trying to offer alternatives and build a culture of life.
And that brings up another question. The abortion providers are complaining about violence against them. Do we have any numbers about violence against pro-lifers? Most recently in the post-Dobbs era here, we've seen a rash of vandalism against Catholic churches and vandalism against pregnancy care centers. Do we have any systematic evidence prior to that, violence against sidewalk counselors, for example? I know one sees anecdotal things, but do we know anything systematic about that, Michael?
You know, off the top of my head, you know, I think pro-lifers probably should, you know, collect that data in a more systematic way. because it does happen. I mean, I generally think sidewalk counseling is a safe activity, and I encourage people to be out there with other people. So the chance something does happen, there's witnesses who can document and verify that. That said, you know, there are circumstances where sidewalk counselors and other people doing, you know, peaceful pro-life ministry, you know, have been attacked and assaulted. Again, it doesn't happen often, but it has happened. And I think that those are circumstances we need to document. Tragically, since Dobbs, one thing we have seen is there's been a lot of violence against churches and a lot of violence against pregnancy help centers. There's a group called Jane's Revenge that seems to be taking credit for a lot of this. They tragically did vandalize one of the pregnancy centers here in Washington, D.C., the Capitol Pregnancy Center, which is probably about a 15-minute walk away from the D.C. Planned Parenthood and not far from Capitol Hill. They were vandalized. And, you know, money they had to spend to, you know, repair the property is money that they can't spend to help women in need. And I thought that was really tragic. It's a group that, you know, has helped my sidewalk counseling ministry out and a group that I try to support. There was a church near Catholic University of America campus, St. Anthony Padua. One of the statues, the head was knocked off. I don't know if that was just a random act of vandalism or if it was because of someone who supported legal abortion. But that was tragic as well. I mean, I think there have been about 40 instances post-Dobbs of either pregnancy centers or churches or pro-life groups being vandalized. You know, I think that's just awful. I think especially with, well, any vandalism is awful, but it really upsets me when I see pregnancy help centers being vandalized because, you know, these groups are trying to help people in need. You know, they really are on the front lines helping, you know, women who often have problems with finances or relationships or other issues. And they're trying to provide, you know, life-affirming alternatives. And, you know, regardless of what one thinks about abortion, I would hope that everyone would agree that helping pregnant women is a good, honorable, and noble activity to engage in. And, you know, when these groups face harassment, I just think that's just really, really tragic.
Well, and their claim is that we're misleading people. That these centers mislead and trick people. And I always want to say, well, you can't trick somebody for 9 months. Yeah. You know, I mean, if you're giving out misleading information, she can check it out the next day because she can abort the baby the next day and the day after that, and the day after that. Mm-hmm. It's the abortion decision that's made in a snap. Yep. You know, you walk in and you have the abortion and your baby's gone forever, you know, and it seems to me very, it's just the opposite of reality for them to say that people are misleading pregnant women in a systematic way over a long period of time. I that doesn't make sense to me that can happen.
Keep in mind, also their own surveys also show that most women who approach pregnancy centers, you know, were happy with the help they got. You know, they didn't feel scammed or misled. You know, if you look at, I would say, I'd tell anyone to compare the Yelp reviews of Planned Parenthood to the Yelp reviews of the pregnancy centers. I think in most, and even people who are sympathetic to legal abortion, often will write very critical reviews of Planned Parenthood on Yelp and these other kind of review websites. They'll say, I support legal abortion, but I had to wait a long time. I wasn't communicated with. People were unfriendly. You know, even though I think abortion should be legal, this Planned Parenthood is doing a crummy job. Most of the reviews of, you know, pregnancy centers that are, you know, not hit pieces, but done by people who actually did visit and did try to get some help, you know, again, they tend to be positive. So, you know, most people are happy with the support they get. And, you know, again, I tell every pro-lifer, you know, when I speak to an audience, identify a local pregnancy center and do what you can to help them out. If you only give a little bit of money, give a little. Sometimes a little goes a long way.
Right. And volunteer to be part of whatever they're doing. Yeah, and there's plenty in the pro-life movement to do. Whatever your skills and talents, you can find some way that you can help. You know, another aspect of this is that criticisms of the pregnancy care centers have been done by people who were going into these centers with the intention of setting them up. You know, so it was like undercover. You know, we're going in there and, oh, they did this, they said this, and they showed us these things, and they did this and this, and it was so misleading. You know, it's not a random survey of what took place, right? It's not let's poll all the customers and see what all the customers have to say. And at least as far as I've seen, these critical reports have not had that feature, you know, where you're interviewing everybody. Is that true as far as you know?
Yeah, I mean, typically it's people with an agenda to try to find things wrong or, you know, catch mistakes. You know, these people are not showing up in good faith to get help. They're trying to, you know, entrap them basically. So that's not really a fair way to evaluate what they do. I mean, if someone's not happy with the kind of care they got, they can just pick up and leave, you know, the pregnancy center. It's really not, you know, a serious horrible infraction. Whereas if a, you know, an abortion clinic, you know, isn't enforcing the pro-life parental involvement law, if they're not, you know, reporting statutory rape, that's a real problem. I mean, right. You know, if young women, people underage present for an abortion, you know, obviously if there's a parental involvement law in place, you know, that needs to be followed. And, you know, they need to be aware of the abortion facilities need to be where there are child predators out there who use abortion to cover up their misconduct. And I'm not really convinced based on what we've seen that abortion facilities are really all that diligent about following up on these things. So, yeah, I think that the kind of misconduct that goes on in abortion facilities is, you know, very serious. It can be catastrophic.
Michael, are there any other things that you've studied that you think would be a value for our listeners to know about? Any other topics that I haven't brought up? I mean, I follow you, but maybe not as closely as I should. What else are you and the Charlotte Lozier Institute up to that people would be interested in?
I mean, I always, you know, talk about the really good progress we've made, you know, getting abortion numbers down. You know, I think that it's just, you know, getting the abortion rate down by 50% since 1980 is a big accomplishment. And I think that, you know, what's interesting, when there's a big public policy success story, you know, gets attention. You know, mm-hmm. that success story could be, you know, a vaccine. It could be the fall of communism. It could be declining crime rates in New York City in the 90s. Usually when something goes well in the field of public policy, it gets attention. Here we've got the abortion rate down by more than half. And outside, you know, a handful of analysts who, you know, really care a lot about this issue, it gets very little attention from the mainstream media. So I think that, you know, pro-lifers just kind of need to, you know, toot their own horn a bit, that, you know, we're doing some things that are effective, obviously. You know, there's still too many abortions and, you know, any is too many. But we have made real progress getting abortion numbers down. I also think another thing I write quite a lot about that I think you and your listeners would be interested in involves this contraception and contraception programs. I think that, you know, pro-lifers get a lot of, I think, really unjust criticism from people saying, yep, you know, why don't you support contraception? You know, if, you know, you just invest more in contraception, that'll get abortion numbers down. Well, we have data on this and we've researched this. And I would argue that most programs to either encourage or promote contraception use tend to be either ineffective at best or counterproductive at worst. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's reasons for this, you know.
But just to be clear, what kind of programs are we talking about? Are we talking about like teen pregnancy programs?
There's
or something
all
like that?
Kinds of things. There's condom distribution programs in public schools. Okay. You know, there are mandates that require employers to cover certain kinds of contraceptions. You know, there's you know, places that, you know, give out contraceptives, you know, for free or, you know, very heavily subsidized. You know, health centers sometimes do this. Again, there's a lot of different programs, you know, especially I'm kind of thinking about ones kind of in the schools, but, you know, can cover a wide range of things. And again, I think that if you just look at the research, again, you find a lot of these programs tend to be kind of ineffective at best or counterproductive at worst. And there's, you know, good reasons for this. You know, first off, contraception currently is, you know, already, you know, pretty available. Guttmacher and the CDC have both done studies of, you know, of sexually active women who weren't using contraception. And they've asked why. And basically, very few women, a very small percentage of women say cost or availability. You know, the reason why many women don't use contraception is sometimes they want to show trust in a partner or sometimes just willing to run the risk of getting pregnant. It's usually not an issue of cost or availability. Seeing there's already programs out there that, you know, pay for contraception or subsidize it, it's not clear that a bigger investment will get contraception use numbers up really, you know, any more or all that much more. Secondly, you know, contraception is a failure rate. You know, and when it fails, typically people oftentimes, you know, obtain abortions. So no contraceptive is 100% of, you know, effective. If you're, you know, giving out contraception, you may well be increasing the pool of sexually active people. People may start to engage in, you know, premarital sexual activity more frequently. That's going to lead to, you know, more pregnancies and, you know, frankly, more abortions. So, you know, that's a reason. Another thing we've also seen is that, you know, contraception use, you know, has gone up by different metrics, but unintended pregnancy rates really have not gone down consistently. Mm-hmm. You know, even though we've seen, you know, consistent increase in contraception use, the unintended pregnancy rate in the U.S. has fluctuated. You've not seen the durable decline in unintended pregnancies that you have in the abortion rate. So, I mean, I think there's just, a lot of good reasons to suggest that, programs to promote contraception use just are typically not going to be all that effective. And that, pro-life people, should not be misled by these groups that want us to make bigger and bigger investments in contraception.
Now, have you studied teen pregnancy programs? A lot of this, there's a number of different sex ed programs that are out there. I wonder if that's something that you've looked at.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. That also gets a very misleading media coverage. Anytime an abstinence program purportedly doesn't work, the media jumps up and down and screams and hollers and points that abstinence programs don't work. And I think, there are some instances of programs that emphasize abstinence, do have a track record of success. But what's kind of even worse in my mind is that a lot of the programs, especially programs directed to teens to encourage contraception use, actually have a very poor success rate.
Right.
The Obama administration launched something they called the Teen Pregnancy Prevention Program. And they gave out a lot of grants to various teen pregnancy prevention programs that emphasize contraception use. And Obama's own HHS, later on, evaluated the program, as it should have. You give out money for a program, you want a grant, you evaluate the grant. Their own HHS basically said this program was a failure. That I think they gave out grants to like 34 programs, and maybe 33 out of the 34 saw no reduction in teen pregnancy. So a vast, vast majority of the programs they funded to try to reduce teen pregnancy rates were failures. And again, these are programs that were kind of based around promoting contraception use. These were not abstinence programs. And obviously, in their write-up, HHS did try to polish it up a little bit. And they said that, the kids in the program learned about STDs and, maybe that's a good thing. But it didn't do what the program was intended to do, which is stop teen pregnancy. So again, there's good research that, again, a lot of these programs promote contraception use amongst teenagers, don't work. But once again, outside conservative and Christian media circles, gets very little attention.
I remember some years ago, I looked into this. It's been at least 10 years since I did a deep dive into these programs, because there's a bunch of them out there, and they're studied one by one because of these grant requirements, right? When the federal government gives you a grant, it's got to be evaluated. And I was very unimpressed, with the success rate. And it almost seemed to me that the only ones that worked consistently were ones that involved the parents somehow.
Yep.
That allowed the parents to be more involved and understand how to talk to their kids, or programs that gave the kids something to do after school instead of sitting around talking about sex and having some nice lady yammer at them about sex.
I think there was a program in like Philadelphia middle schoolers that actually did include some after school activity components, and the kids could have the option to play some sports. It did include some sex ed instruction, but wasn't just sex ed. It include some activities that kids might have enjoyed, and that program was found to be effective. So think that there's ways you can kind of work on these programs a bit.
So that's not what you and I intended to talk about today, but I think it's an important point that when people hear about this kind of thing, these are the questions you should be asking. If somebody tells you we need to invest more in teen pregnancy prevention programs, you need to ask, well, exactly what do you have in mind? What exactly are you promoting? What exactly are you discouraging? And show me the numbers. Did it actually work? Has it actually worked? Because we've now got a lot of track record on a lot of these programs. I need to get some. Do you know who studies this, Michael? Who's the best person who keeps track of this? Do you know?
I think that, Wade Horn, who used to be with, Health and Human Services, has done some work on this. I was actually, the Trump administration did hire me, that they were interested in funding some, different programs. And, I was part of a team to kind of evaluate them. Mm-hmm. We ran into a lot of trouble kind of getting approval, that the Obama administration signed some contracts and kind of carried over. And the Trump administration wanted to cancel these contracts, but couldn't. So some of the ideas they had never really kind of got off the ground the way I think the Trump administration wanted them to. I think we could use kind of a bit more, people kind of involved in analyzing and, researching, these teen pregnancy programs. And again, I think that a lot of things that, are being promoted to, encourage contraception use, just simply, regardless of what one thinks about the morality of contraception, I think the empirical data is pretty clear that all these programs just don't work well. I think that more research, more writing on this would be welcome.
Mm-hmm. Well, Michael, is there anything else you want to tell us about? We're coming to the end of our time, but I'm very glad that you've been able to spend some time with us and tell people about what you're doing and what the Charlotte Lozier Institute is doing. Is there anything else you'd like to tell us about?
Well, just want to encourage listeners out there, obviously what happened in Kansas, earlier this month was, a disappointment and a setback. But I just want to let listeners know, we were never promised a smooth glide path to victory, okay? There's going to be disappointments and aggravations along the way. We just have to keep doing our work to build a culture of life. That election day in Kansas, that wasn't our day, but the future's ours. As of mid to late September, 16 states are going to be having some legal protections of preborn children in place. According to Guttmacher, this is a research study they did back in July, 43 facilities that used to do abortions no longer are, and that number is probably higher now. And we've gotten some good data from pregnancy help centers that Heartbeat International has said their hotline is seeing 15% more serious calls, serious inquiries post-Dobbs. These aren't crank calls. Right. These are serious inquiries, and more than half of their pregnancy centers are seeing more clients post-Dobbs. So the future is ours. We just have to grab it.
Well, Michael, can you give us the website of the Charlotte Lozier Institute or any other place where you publish your research?
Sure. Our website is just lozierinstitute.org. If your listeners want to follow me, the best way to do so is on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @Michael_J_new. That's @Michael_J_new. Your listeners can also friend me on Facebook. Chances are, if you listen to the show, we have some friends in common, and I'll accept the friend request of a pro-lifer. So if I write anything, I blog anything on the radio, I always put it on Twitter, and that's a good way to stay in touch with me.
Michael New, thank you so much for being my guest today on the Dr. J Show.
Thanks for having me. It was fun.